Assistant Professor and Coordinator of this FDP, Department of CSE, welcomes all to the last day of the 1 week online FDP on Perspectives of Online Teaching and Learning, organized by the Department of Humanities and Sciences, GRIIT, Hyderabad. Thank you all for being here this morning. Dear participants, due to some technical issues, our today's speaker is unable to handle the session. So one of my teammates of the FDP will handle today's session. It gives me an immense pleasure to introduce our today's speaker, Ms. STGY Sandhya, co-convener of FDP, who could enlighten us on the topic Tools for Virtual Classroom. STGY Sandhya is a research scholar at JNTU Hyderabad. She has completed her Master of Technology in Computer Science and Engineering and Bachelor of Technology in CSE. She is having over 9 years of academic experience and guided many projects in the field of security and networks. Her research interests include cloud computing and network security, wireless networks. She has qualified in Telangana SET in 2017. She stood as topper in problem solving through programming in C and in data structures and algorithms using C NPTEL in the year 2018. She is certified as Microsoft Certified Educator in 2017 and Microsoft Technology Associate in 2016. Now I will hand over to today's speaker to address the participants. Over to you, Sandhya ma'am.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for such beautiful words. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Okay, I'll first share my screen and then check. Sir, is the screen visible? Hello?
Yes, 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 yes.
Okay.
Please be a little louder.
Okay, sure. Thank you. Good morning, participants. I am Sandhya, Assistant Professor in CSE Department, Gokaraja Rangaraju Institute of Engineering and Technology. I take the privilege to hand over to handle the session today. So what am I going to talk about as tools for virtual classrooms? Given a context, I would prefer to start it this way. My dear fellow participants, my dear fellow teachers, we are all thrown into a situation where we don't have any idea of what is going to come during March when lockdown was imposed. Classrooms were shut, the colleges were shut, students were at home, we were at home, we were asked to do a lot of things which we had no clue or no idea about. Though we learned a couple of times about how to probably record a video, how to share it, how to work with flipped classroom techniques, nothing was so very regular to us because we had that physical connect with students. When we missed that physical connect, we ultimately went into a zone where probably this is what that has come for us. So I believe all of us somewhere down the line were thrown into this particular zone. Offline teaching to online teaching. How did it happen? What happened? What did we went through? Many of us, or most of us, will definitely accept the fact that we have underwent a lot of trouble. This is what the Kubler-Ross change curve says. Kubler-Ross is a psychiatrist who worked on a lot of issues, and one of that is this change curve. We all know that change is constant. So whenever we are forced to accept something, we were in shock. We then deny to do certain things, then we are frustrated, then we get into depression. I believe this phase we all have gone through during this lockdown time. And then we slowly started experimenting things, then we took up some decisions, and probably now at this point of time, after around 2 months of lockdown, we are now at this stage where we are trying to integrate the possible solutions which we felt into real life to just accept the change. So my dear friends, let me take the opportunity to take you through a few of the tools that I have experimented with during this lockdown period in my virtual classrooms. So I take the privilege to take you all through a few tools that I have experimented. So let's start with this. What are the changes faced by teachers during online teaching? Most of us, or many of you, will accept this fact that, you know, we don't have the digital skill set, lack of resources, unfamiliarity of teaching online, time management, we were less conversant, apathy towards online teaching, rethinking and replanning of how to do entire course structure, no clarity of what tools and technologies to use, struggling to find out a right tool and troubleshooting. I believe most of you agree to all this. Some of my friends did not find a right tool to teach their subject. Some of my friends did not understand how are they supposed to troubleshoot when a problem arises. Some of them have no idea of what is a right tool for them. Some of us were unable to rethink and replan our course because we probably had half of the course done and another half pending. All of us went through all these challenges. So now, what do I learn? Even when I was put to all these questions, what did I learn? What did I experiment? What did I explore? This is how I have started. So I got, let us now take this, see the session this way. I will probably tell you a few questions that all of us might have somewhere down the line in this 3 months. So I probably try to share a few answers that that we felt are apt to the question that is proposed. So therefore, here goes my question number one. Okay, what is question number one? How do you get to know if your students have seen the entire video? So what? Okay, initially we recorded a video. We made the video. We uploaded it to either Google Drive or Moodle or YouTube and then shared the link with students. That has all happened. Now, how do you ensure that your students had seen the full video? This is the question. So is there any answer for this? Of course, there are a few answers. The solutions are embed the video in a Google form and conduct a quiz. This is already told to us by the previous speaker, Sri Vijay Ramraj Garu. So you can, in a Google form, embed your video URL. The people can see the video and then answer the questions. That is answer number one. Answer number two, share the video first of all, previously before, and during your online session, pose some questions to ensure that if students have seen the video. But both of this have got their own set of disadvantages. You don't really know whether students are answering just like that, and you can't ensure or assure that your students have seen the entire video. So there comes the question, do I have another option? The answer is yes. There is a tool called Edpuzzle, which is, you know, this is the URL, edpuzzle.com. Edpuzzle is a tool which helps us to trim or cut an irrelevant part of a video, allows you to give voiceover. That means we can dub an existing video, and embed the questions into the videos as reflection spots, just like how it happens in video lectures. So these are all the possible advantages that Edpuzzle gives us. So if I want my students to answer questions that comes in between like pop-ups, yes, I can do that with Edpuzzle. If I took a 10-minute video and felt some 5 minutes of it is not useful, only the 5 minutes matter is enough, I can trim it from both the sides and get my video short and answer a few questions. Also, we all know that, or we were all aware of the fact that there are a large number of free videos available with CC license in YouTube and many other repositories, NPTEL videos, spoken tutorial lectures, etc. So if you felt that Khan Academy lectures, etc. So if you felt that your questions can be answered, or if you felt that somewhere in between the video, you needed something to be told to your students on your personal note, yes, you can do that. Edpuzzle provides us with all that. Now, then comes the next question. Is it a free tool? Yes. Edpuzzle is free and proprietary as well. For the free version, it supports 20 videos per user. So you log into Edpuzzle as a teacher, then you can use up to 20 videos. When you collaborate with your friends, you will get little more videos to add up. But in general, Edpuzzle supports 20 videos. So my dear friends, let me take you through this tool called Edpuzzle. So here it is. This is how Edpuzzle looks. Edpuzzle.com is the website that all of us need to refer to. So Edpuzzle.com, then you go to Edpuzzle.com. This is Edpuzzle.com and you got to create a class. This is my class for today, day 6 demo, which is seen on the screen. I will share it to you also. So this is the class code. Once when my students join this class with this class code, they can check the video assignments that I have given to them and they can start working. So this is how it happens. So let me take you through. Let's see the Edpuzzle demo. This is my class, edpuzzle.com/join. So let me take you through this. So yes, here we go. Hello, sir. Are you able to see a browser?
Yes, yes.
Yes, thank you. So here we go. Let us check out this Edpuzzle. Madam, can you paste the link in chat box? For participants to join. Dear participants, a link for Edpuzzle will be placed in the chat box. Kindly join. It asks you for login. A few of you can go through how does Edpuzzle work if you're interested. It asks you for login. If you're using it through mobile, it asks you for download an app, but it just takes 2 minutes. Edpuzzle is the tool that we are going to try. If you are unable to do so, I will show it to you on the screen. So I just clicked Edpuzzle.com, which is the website that I'm referring to. Requesting all the participants to kindly join. This is the tool Edpuzzle that I wanted to show it to you. Click on Edpuzzle. It opens up to a new window. So this is actually my class, which I have designed. I'll show it to you how does it look also. So my dear friends, just take a minute to see what I have done. These are a few videos that I had. How do you do it on Edpuzzle? First, let me take you through how do you do it on Edpuzzle. When you click on Edpuzzle.com, you're asked to log in as teacher or as student. So you log in as student using your any Gmail account or create an account. Then inside that, you got to create your class. And then if I want to add something, say suppose this is a basic window and I want to add something, then just click on content.
Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. It's there in the chat box.
Thank you. So the link for the class is placed in the chat box. You can join that to just see how it happens. But before that, let me show you how does it actually work. Okay, let me just go back. So my dear friends, this is one of the video of mine, which is there on YouTube. I just pasted that and I wanted to ensure whether my students have learned it or not, have gone through or not. So therefore, I've just done this. I've just placed it. I have had a few questions. I have added a few questions, which comes as pop-up. So when I'm doing it from a teacher's end, this is how the screen looks. So at 0.25 seconds is a multiple choice question. At 5.20 is another multiple choice question. This is how it is. This is the video, a 15 minute video in which I have embedded around 5 to 6 questions for my participants to answer, for my students to answer. So I will assign this to my students to get my job done. Once when this is done, there is something called as gradebook here. Hope you are able to see. Once when this is done, this is how you get to see. Only a few of my students just have gone through that for 33 seconds. Rest all did not. So this is how it looks. There is one more video that I can show it to you. You can understand. So these are a few classes that I have conducted. I have taken. So this is Grid PPS class where my students have taken up an assignment. So yeah, hope you are able to see the difference. This is what my students have done on this date. Someone has watched all the 15 minutes. Someone has only watched for 4 minutes. Someone has just watched for 13 minutes. This is how it goes. 4 minutes, 0 minutes, 15 minutes, 0 seconds, 6 minutes, 16 minutes. They answered a few questions in 6 minutes and just went away. 4 minutes, 25 minutes. So this is what I wanted to show you, this tool called Edpuzzle. So let me again go to my classes. Let me put a disclaimer. Doing all this has got nothing to do with your e-certificate. We just wanted to show you that this is how it works. So this is a demo class that I have conducted for today. So what did I do in this? There are 35 students who could join this class. So people are doing this. A few have joined and people are doing this. That's what is shown to me. So great documentary Edpuzzle demo. This is what I did. Let me show it to you what did I do. So hope you are able to see it. There are a few people who just started watching this a few seconds ago. A few people. So this is how you will be able to see. You can give your deadline. When do you want it to start? Here is an option on the left, on the right corner. When do you want to start? When do you want to stop? This is an interesting option. When using Edpuzzle, this seems to be an interesting option. Hope you are able to make it. It is called prevent skipping. Suppose if you have sent a 5 minutes video and some 3 questions embedded in it, your students can simply drag the video to a question place and then simply answer the question and wind off the job. If you feel that you are teaching a very important point and wanted your students not to skip anything, then you just on it, your students has to watch the entire video. I have actually, you know, tried this prevent skipping. So that's why people got to watch entire video. So now let me make it like this. When I off this, they can just simply drag and get the job done. So if you are doing this video, anyone, you can simply drag it and get the job done. So more about Edpuzzle is present in edpuzzle.com. You can refer to that. There are a lot of YouTube videos available to work with Edpuzzle. An interesting tool, if you believe that some topic is very essential and you want all your students to definitely go through that, to check the students' progress, Edpuzzle seems to be a very relevant and very important tool in this context, where you are not sure of how is it happening. So this is what I tried. I embedded a few things. I did voiceover to this. I did everything possible on this just to show you that it works this way. So also let me tell you, my dear friends, this is a small documentary on GRIT, which is recorded in 2017 with the then principal, Sri Jainam Garu, and director, sir, Sri P.S. Rajak Garu. So I tried to embed my voiceover for some time in the starting and towards the end. And in between, I kept it as it is. Just to show you that whenever you need it, some point needs to be explained in your voice. You can add a voice note to that at that point, or you can also dub your voice on that at that particular point. Both are possible. If you want a voice note to pop up at that point, go there, click on voice note, give you a voice note, it pops up. You can try this. I'm not closing this. The URL is shared. It will also be shared in WhatsApp after the session. So you can try this and you can explore the tool called Edpuzzle. So this is about Edpuzzle. After people are done, you will just get to see. These are the people who have joined. Yeah, here you can see progress. Balakrishnan Selvakumar has done. So how many points he has got? Reset is progress, unassign. All that can be done from a teacher's point of view. So this is how it shows. Every student's progress is clearly seen by the teacher. It only allows 50 students per class. So if you have large number of students, you better divide your Edpuzzle into two classes. Give the two links separately for your students to get your job done. So this is one tool called Edpuzzle. Most of you might be aware of the fact that Edpuzzle is a video editing tool that helps us. Also, let me tell you, Edpuzzle allows YouTube videos to directly embed. Edpuzzle allows you to use Khan Academy videos straight away. Edpuzzle also allows a lot of videos available in Edpuzzle created by various, you know, teachers who belong to so many other platforms. There are so many teachers who work on Edpuzzle and create free videos. But the disadvantage with Edpuzzle, though Edpuzzle can be linked up with Google Classroom and can be shared as a URL to students, the problem that comes with Edpuzzle is you can't download this video and use it for some other purpose out of Edpuzzle. That's what Edpuzzle doesn't support. If you want to use a video embedded in Edpuzzle, you got to log into Edpuzzle and use it. That's the only drawback of Edpuzzle. You can't do it outside a class, outside of Edpuzzle. That doesn't support. That's the disadvantage of Edpuzzle. So let me now take you through another tool. Hope I'm okay with this tool. So here goes my second tool. Second question to answer. So my dear friends. Yes, hello, any issue? Sir, is there any issue?
No, nothing.
No, no, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So well, here goes my second question. That is, all your queries will be answered towards the end of the session. Please allow me to continue with the session. So the second question is, how do you get your recording script into your material? So here we go. We have just discussed a minute ago that all of us in the starting of this lockdown created videos, uploaded into YouTube or our Google Drives, shared it with our students, asked them to prepare. So after that, what happened? For every topic we teach, we got to give a notes. All our lecture notes is handwritten and is kept in our college or somewhere in the house, which, you know, which we are unable to get it. Or in a context where we got to prepare a 10 to 12 minute video, it requires a 2 to 3 pages of lecture material or a handout or in other words, you can call it as a script. How do I get the script ready? I speak a lot though I put few points on PowerPoint, we usually speak a lot. Your video has more matter than the points that are seen on PowerPoint, that all of us know, because we keep our points on PowerPoint to be crisp. So therefore comes the question, how do you get your recordings a script? So whatever you talk need to be scripted, and that needs to be, that will be helpful if that is directly given to the students as a lecture material. So therefore, how do you get this job done? Imagine I'm taking up a topic. How do I get this job done? The common things that we kept on doing till date. We have been doing all this. This is nothing new. We know the answer also. The answer that I used to do, what I used to do is, I used to type the matter, get it ready, and then give it to my students. Make it as PDF, share a Word doc and give it to my students. That's the first one. The second one that I also done is, I have written all the matter on a piece of paper, take the photos, converted that into PDF and shared with my students. I guess you all agree with this two answers of mine, I believe, because this is what we have been doing throughout. We write the matter on a paper, convert it into PDF, share it with students, or else we type all the matter if it is programs. Basically, we teach programming language, so therefore we usually type the programs on our Windows, then share the screenshots with our students. So therefore, these two are the options that we already know. So here goes the next question. Is there any other option? The answer is yes. Okay, but this has a clause. This has a conditions apply kind of thing. So what is that? If you feel speaking is easy, only then you will like this tool. Otherwise, you don't like this tool. Okay, so let me show you. If you feel, rather than typing a 2 pages of material, for me, it is easy to read out. If you feel that it's easy to read out, then here is an answer from my side. The answer is using voice typing technique in Google Docs. Google Docs, as already shared and explained by Vijayaram Raju sir, we will just see one or two points of Google Doc that might also become handy for all of us in our endeavors in future. So therefore, I will now take you through a technique called voice typing in Google Docs. So where is voice typing present? So my dear friends, you got to open your Google Doc. How do you open your Google Doc? Let me tell you the steps. Step one, go to your Gmail account. Step two, go to Drive. Drive in your Gmail account. This is my Drive as seen on the screen. Inside that Drive, go to New, click on Google Doc, and then here is your Google Doc. Inside Google Doc, there are a few tabs, and inside the tab, there is something called as Tools. In the Tools, there are a lot of tools. If we explore, we get a lot of uses from them, but still, let us only limit ourselves to this tool called voice typing, which is quite interesting. So yes, let's move on to this topic called voice typing. So this is a tool called voice typing. And now what does voice typing do? Voice, you can type and edit by speaking in Google Docs or in Google Slides speaker notes. So there's an Android version also possible if you want to quickly do it, not open your computer and do it, because many of us require a good internet connection to connect our computers and start working. But with mobile, that may be a bit easy. So you also have got an Android version of Google Docs. You just, use that Android version. Here is the matter for that. You can just use the Android version, use the speaker button, and then start speaking through the Google Docs so that all the whatever you spoke just gets texted. So yes, there are a few problems with this that you will understand while I show you a demo. But before that, get your lengthy documents. What is the advantage of this? I am one who finds it little difficult, or probably to be truthful, I find it very difficult to type 2 to 3 pages of matter. Instead, I believe I write and take a photo and just post it, convert it into PDF and use it for reference. That's what I usually do. But now, for people who find typing is difficult than speaking, here is an option for you. You get your lengthy documents typed with ease. That is the advantage of Google Docs. More about Google Docs, you can check out in the URL provided, that is support@google.com. But now let's move to seeing the demo of Google Docs. Yes, Google Docs voice typing demo. Let's take up the voice typing demo from Google Docs. So I would want to open a Google document, which will take us through this process of voice typing. Okay. Okay. Hello, sir. Is the screen visible? The browser screen?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, I needed access.
Ma'am, the link is pasted in the chat box regarding tools voice typing.
Okay. Yes. So I needed to log in. It says me. It is asking me to log in. So okay, I'll just log in. I'll just log in with my Gmail account because I'm talking about Google Docs. This is not needed. You need not try on the link because I didn't share it. Okay, let's do this. Gmail. Here I go. This is my Gmail account. I'm logging in through my Gmail account. I'll take you through the process. This is an interesting tool. Okay, this is my inbox. I will just go to Google Drive. Sorry. Just click on Google Drive. Okay, click on new. You require an internet connection to do this because Google Docs happen online, but there is an offline version also available. You can use that. And later on, when you sync all your data that you have used gets automatically synced to the drive. So I use a Google Doc. I'm just preparing a new blank document. I only wanted you to check out this feature called voice typing. So I'm just checking this voice demo. Voice type demo. I'm just taking this voice type demo. So my dear friends, there's a lot to this voice type demo. You can check out from Google. There are a lot of interesting facts about this, but let me first show you. Here is a tool. I just go to tools, click on voice demo, voice typing. Okay. So please just try to see. This is an option just about the speaker button is an option where all of you are asked to check out for the language I wanted to type. So it is English US here. So I can select the language that I wanted to speak. There are a lot of languages. All these are the languages accepted. English for us, what do we better understand is English, Telugu, Hindi are there because I don't know the other language, other Indian languages like Marathi, Tamil and Kannada. I limit myself to these three languages, which I know, I mean, which I'm able to speak. So let me start and show it to you. I'll just speak. Good morning, all the participants. Good morning, one and all. I am STG by Sandhya. Take this opportunity to thank you all for joining me for 2 days. Session. Oh, there is a mistake here. For today's session. Yes, if your pronunciation is not okay, there might be a few mistakes. But rather than typing a 2 to 3 pages of document, It is absolutely okay to edit it. Isn't it? What do you say? Once I'm done, I just need to stop it. Editing is also possible, but editing, you can also edit using this feature. That is also possible, but that requires little amount of understanding and exploration from the user. The user is expected to explore a bit more, learn the voice commands of Google Docs, and then probably say, my dear friends, I have not touched any of my controls of keypad. I've just spoken whatever I wanted to. And that is
sorry to interrupt, ma'am.
Sorry.
Madam, your voice typing is not seen on the screen.
Are you not finding anything on the screen? Is the Google Doc not visible?
Just the link is visible on the screen. Link you have. You're showing the link. But whatever you are saying, voice typing, that is not seen on the screen.
Okay, I'll just stop share and do it once again. Please let me know. Okay, I'll start sharing once again. Please just let me know, madam. Ma'am, now please let me know what is seen on the screen.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, ma'am.
Are you able to see a plain document?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, we are able to see now.
Okay, then I will do
it. Once again, you can repeat, madam.
Thank you. Please just let me know if it is not visible on the screen. Okay, now I go. So, my dear friends, I'm sorry for that. I thought it is visible, but it's okay. So yes, here we go. As I told, it requires little more patience and exploration from the user of Google Docs to kindly practice all the voice commands and then probably even edit the document also. Before getting to that, you can even use your language. You can even just speak and get your 2 to 3 pages document typed with ease, probably in 10 or 15 minutes, and then simply edit it for another 10 minutes and you're done. So here I go. This is a tool. There is an option called tools. In that, there is something called voice typing. I have clicked it. When I clicked it, this particular small pop-up with a mic symbol appears on my Google Doc. So when this appears, it can be moved anywhere. And this is an option for you to select your language. I can select anything. So now I have selected US, English US. So therefore it's able to, you know, record me in English US. There are so many options. You can explore it after my session. So here I go. I'm not talking. So yes. Hello participants. On behalf of Perspectives of Online Teaching and Learning, Faculty Development Program, I welcome you all to this FDP. There is a mistake. Because I was in a hurry. Until I stop, whatever I speak just gets recorded. Isn't it a good tool? So this is what I have explored in Google Docs. Voice typing. But let me add a bit more and make it exciting. Okay, so this is what I've just kept a full stop because I wanted to show you something else. So let me change another language. Imagine, I don't know, most of us doesn't know how to type in Telugu, but a lot of people, you know, keep messaging in Telugu and all. So I generally struggle with doing that. I know how to speak, but typing Telugu, I don't know. Yes, there is an option called Google Translators. All of us know we can use that. But still, there's one more amazing tool here. So that is, I'll just select the language called Telugu. Here it comes. Okay, let me show you Hindi first. Very few lines I'm going to speak. Yes, I'm going to... Namaskar. Aap kaise ho? Phir se? So this is how it works. Hope you have seen this. Namaskar, aap kaise ho phir se? It is exactly 100% correct. As long as you speak slowly, crisply, it works well. But the moment when we just struggle or when we just end up saying something that's not understandable, it throws an error. But that's not an issue. It only takes very limited time for us to kindly, you know, check out. So Marathi and all also will work here, but I'm just limiting to Telugu. Once I take Telugu, I'll just close the session. I'll just close this. So let's move to Telugu. That's our language here. So, Andarki, Namaskaram. Ela unnaru. Thank you. It just started typing in thank you also. So this is how it happens. This is what I explored. I felt this is an amazing tool which helps me to get my job, you know, done in a very quick time. So this is about Google Docs. There's another interesting aspect about Google Docs. Let me also show that to you, because we might again need to shift, which becomes little problem. So therefore, friends, let me take you through another important option that we can explore using Google Docs. That's the question number three that I actually wanted to ask all of you, that I'll show it to you in the PPT as well. So many a times, we always understand the fact that a lot of times we quickly write something in a piece of paper. Yes, when it is urgently, we quickly write something in a piece of paper. And then we were asked to translate that into a Word document. I mean, we are asked to translate that into text. So what do? Generally, we write off, we take a photograph, and then later come back and start typing it. That's option number one. Option number two, you just put that photograph into a PDF and again use that only. Use that. But we are talking about translation of documents. If I'm asked to translate a document, which is in terms of a PDF or which is in terms of an image, there is... I'm talking about text because it becomes difficult for images on Google Docs. I'm trying to convert using a Google Doc a matter that is imposed in PDF or on an image into a Word document. So how does that generally happen with Google Docs? So let me take you through any PDF that I have. I have a couple of PDFs here in which there should be some data. So here I go. My dear friends, this is my call letter for something. I have some call letter. Okay. Let me just take it. I do a right click. There is some call letter in my drive, which is a PDF. So I wanted to show you. Then I just say, open with, sorry. Okay. I just say, open with Google Docs. Open with Google Docs. There's a call letter of mine. I've just opened that with Google Docs. It takes a couple of minutes. There are a few pros and cons here. I will tell you, but before that, I wanted you to have a look at it. I will also show you how does image gets translated. My dear friends, except images, rest all gets translated. So here is something that's coming. I will also show it to you another one. So let's move and see a few things. Let's go to my drive. Okay. One second, I'm sorry. This is my Google Drive. Okay, let me take you through something else. Okay, there's something called STGY demo. Yes, this is what I have explored in this process. This is my folder in which I have tried a few things. I'll show it to you, then we'll see how does it work. Yeah, this is our text. We just wrote something and just took a photo and sent it to my friend. So here it is. Some English writing in an image. That's an image which I just sent to my friend. So I'm opening with Google Doc. Hope you have seen that. That is an image which I have just taken a photo from my side and sent it to my friend. So this is how it goes. The image seems to be appearing like an image. You don't have any option for this, but yes, just check out what is seen here. A. Shravanti coordinated something. Yeah, all the matter, including my, the stamp that I get on my, this one. This is what I usually get when I take a photo from my side, including that watermark. It is translated. So I would like to let you know a few things, my dear friends. The point number one is, when you convert any document into a Google Doc, you can't edit here. At this point of time, in this place, you can't edit it immediately. So what have you got to do? You just need to copy the text and put it in another Word doc and then edit it. Or you can convert this into a Microsoft Office Word document, because there is an option called download. Inside that, you can just download it, download into various options possible, and then start editing it. So anytime from rather than using an online tool, uploading a document, getting it, rather than that, I feel this to be an easy way. You can work with PDFs. You can also work with images. You can also work with any other type of documents where there is text embedded in it. It becomes difficult if there is image, because images usually does not get converted. There are certain rules associated with it, but most of the times, any text that is clearly written. You might ask a next question. Will this only work for computerized text? That means, will this only work for the text that I have just typed? So when I just explored this tool, I just took a screenshot. Hope you are able to make it. I'll show it to you on the screen. Madam, is it visible? Madam, is my screen clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes.
So yes, this is just a snapshot which I took from a newspaper randomly. There are a few images and some text in Telugu. So I use this option called as open with Google Doc. And I would like to show you what happened when I did that. So this is what I got. The image appeared to be like image, but after that, except the image in that particular file, I got it back. So yes, including the watermark, whenever I take a snapshot. So this is what I observed. So this is about Telugu. So it does even Telugu also. So therefore, and I will show you another thing, which okay. Let me take a minute's time and just show you another thing. Hope this becomes a useful tool in your virtual classroom teaching. So let me take you through another tool. Okay. Close. Let me go back. Yeah. I then asked a friend of mine to probably share some of handwritten material. So when I did this open with Google Doc, asked a friend of mine to share some English handwritten material. So she does that to me. And when I did it, this is what I got. Yes, these documents requires probably little amount of editing, but rather than typing the entire document, I feel this is a better option. So this is about the things that I wanted to share to you about Google Docs. So I now stop sharing and go to another important topic that I am here for. So hope I made my point clear. Google automatically saves all your documents to Drive. So it is compulsory to go and do it through Drive. So my dear friends, it becomes essential for all of you to do it through Google Drive. If you want to work with Google Docs, you got to work with Google through Google Drive. So that's from my side. So let's share the screen and proceed to the next topic. In the next 40 to 30 minutes, we are going to see gamification and quizzing techniques that are possible. So this is what I've told you. So yes, let's take the session forward. Okay. Madam, is the PPT seen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you. So here is the third one that I talked about. Possible solutions is, have you tried using open with Google Docs concept? This is an open with Google Docs concept. Here is a text image that I used. When I used open with Google Docs, it just gets there. The problem is you can't edit the text documents in Google Docs. You can only copy it and do it in another window. But even then, that provides probably a very, very time-saving option for us. So this is what it is. We have seen the demo already. There are a few tips. Just like how I told, you can use it in offline. So here goes for the question number four, the topic that is actually very interesting. Let's just check out now. So what does it say? Engaging students is arguably even more important in virtual classrooms. We take up a session of 30 minutes, 40 minutes, 1 hour, 1.5 hour through online. And at times we don't even know whether the students on the other end are actually responding to us, listening to us or not. Because we know what are we doing is what the students also might be doing on the other end. So my dear friends, when this comes as a bigger problem, what becomes bigger problem is keeping the students stick to your classrooms, be there in your classrooms, trying to catch hold of their, you know, interests. All this becomes important. So therefore, obviously, the first main concern of virtual classrooms would be engaging the students to have a greater amount of learning possible. So how do you engage your students, but still learning should happen? So what are all the possible solutions? This is what the experts has to say. So the experts around the world have just stated that there are a few options that you probably can use and relate to in your particular domain to check out how do you maintain that engagement factor in your virtual classrooms. So creating a student-teacher relationship, a personal connect. If we are in our classroom, we have a personal connect with our students. Now we probably need to have an e-connect, I guess. So having that e-connect with our students, making the class small so that we have concentration on all the students and the lessons crisp. You can't drag and speak to people over an online classroom because that becomes boring. So therefore the lessons needed to be crisp. And then comes questions and more questions. So this is what it is stated by a lot of people. You got to ask questions. You got to again ask questions and you got to ask more and more questions. So that's what. So I highlighted this point because for the next 30 minutes, we're going to see only about this topic called questions and more questions. So then what about this too? Constant progress check-ins, use flipped classroom designs and create rewarding methods for the students. So use constant progress check-ins as something like you're doing better. These people are lagging. That kind of monitoring from a teacher's perspective. Flipped classroom, again, a concept comes. This used to happen when we are there in classrooms. How do we modify that to suit to virtual classrooms? Probably give out a video before your lecture starts, ask the students to prepare, and then have a question and answer session or a related kind of topic in the next session. that would probably help us. We probably need to mount ourselves to develop a better flipped classroom strategies for virtual classrooms as well. So then the last one is creating rewarding methods for students. Whenever people do it online, all the assignments, there should be something called, in Moodle, there is a concept called as badging. Virtual badges are gaining more and more prominence in these days to encourage students. There are badges like first done, the fastest, the quickest, good performer, continuous performer, topper, all these kinds of badges, or a lot of badges are there, which teachers create and award to students who score a particular points, a specific credentials, who fulfill a specific credentials. So you can check out digital badges in Google. You get a lot of resources. This happens with Moodle. Badging system is there in Moodle that we can probably try out to ensure that students have that competitive spirit to get the job done. So yes, let's move on. Our focus will only be on this topic called as questions, questions, and more questions. So how is this possible in virtual classrooms? There are three techniques that make it possible in virtual classrooms. The first one is quizzes, conduction of quizzes. The second one is gamification techniques. And the third one is collaborative activities. So I would like to show all the three, but only if time permits. So my dear friends, let me take you through the first topic, that is quizzes. So how do you conduct quizzes online? By this time, all of us have become experts in conducting online quizzes. We are probably taking 10 to 15 minutes. Once upon a time, we used to take around 1 hour to prepare a Google form and start a quiz. Now we are just, you know, a Google form with five questions. We are doing it in 5 to 10 minutes. To that extent, we have probably increased all our capabilities and understanding of a tool called Google Form. Since Google Form is already spoke about by Sir, I would like to not touch it, and I would like to just probably go ahead and take up something which is very interesting and which is not touched upon in our FDP. So my dear friends, assessments are essential because they help us know how our students are performing. They help us access our students better. They help us, you know, they help us to understand who's a better performer, who's not performing, all this kind of things about a student. So therefore, the tools generally used for assessments are, you can use Google Forms that all of us are well aware of. Then Moodle or LMS quizzes, any learning management system has quizzes already imbibed in it. So therefore, you can use any of the Moodle techniques to start off a quiz. Edmodo is another beautiful, interesting platform which provides a lot of activities, assignment submissions, classrooms, meeting rooms, etc. And quizzes in Edmodo is also an interesting feature. Then whiteboard.fi is a tool which gives the concept of whiteboards and blackboards into teaching. So then there are a lot of tools which usually people describe. Let's go to the gamification techniques. What does gamification mean? As the name says, gamification is a concept of probably having a game-like exam, a game-like assessment, a game-like thing involved in a classroom teaching so that students become more engaged. Again, this clearly depends on the perception of the teacher. There are a few teachers who say people are more addicted to video games, and now again you have gaming into classroom. Gaming should not come into classroom. Classroom should only have serious studies. This is one opinion of some teachers around the world. And on the other hand, there are a few teachers who also accept the fact that, yes, maybe if I introduce a gamification or a game kind of exam assessment in my classroom, I might probably get little more interest from my students, where I actually don't know how our students performing. It is totally depend upon the professor, on the teacher's perspective, but I personally believe gamification helped me a lot. After 1 month of lockdown, I started using a lot of gaming techniques into my classrooms to just ensure to just check if my students are all doing it or not to assess them, not to check out. I found it as a platform to better explain them what is correct, what is not about a concept. And I also found it as an interesting way of getting to them. So here are a few pros and cons as suggested by experts. Pros are increasing student engagement, creates enthusiasm, gives instant feedback, and makes social connections. And the cons are cost, student assessment, game logistics, and decreased student span, decreased attention span. So these are a few pros and cons. Hope you agree to all this because we are the people who work on this. So depending upon our perspectives, let me take you through the third one that is also very interesting and very entertaining and informative these days. Most of the teachers are keeping their students do collaborative activities. So collaboration has just become another important aspect of how the world is now running. So the collaborative activities include Google Jamboards, Padlets, etc. A lot of tools support collaborative activities. Just like how we have seen on the day 4, you can collaborate using Google Doc, you can collaborate using spreadsheets a lot. So in the same way, there are a few tools that helps you to collaborate. Google Jamboards and Padlets are very interesting tools. I wish you to explore once if you would love to check out collaboration. So what are we going to see now for another 20 minutes or 30 minutes? For another 20 to 30 minutes, my dear friends, I will take you through these tools called Mentimeter, Testmos, Kahoot, Quizzes, MyQuiz, and Quizlet. So Mentimeter is already explored by us on day 3 at the start of the session. So Mentimeter is a free tool that allows the users to play 5 quizzes only. Every tool that I'm talking now, Kahoot, Quizzes, Testmos, Mentimeter, MyQuiz, Quizlet, etc., are all have proprietary paid versions and free versions also. Implied that free version has a limited amount of access. So when free version has limited amount of access, it depends upon the teacher to use it in a meaningful way. So if it supports only 50 students, and in general, all our class strength is 60. So what do I choose? I prefer to make it 2 halves. I distribute the first assignment to the first students and the second assignment to second students, because 50, I make it 30-30. I make it into 2 halves. I just duplicate the assignment. I keep it as copy 1, copy 2, copy 1 to first set of students and copy 2 to second set of students. That is my way of doing it. You can also plan different assignments. That might be your perspective. So Mentimeter only allows 5 questions per quiz in a single day. So it only allows 5 questions. So whenever you are doing a class and wanted to at the end or at the start test how are your students doing for about 5 minutes, you can use Mentimeter. The advantage with Mentimeter is it allows you to ensure that you have time limit for every topic. If you feel that a question needs to be answered quickly, you can set less time. If you feel something needs to have more time or thought upon, then you can give more time. So that's what Mentimeter does. Similarly, there are a lot more quizzes. Out of this, before I start and asking you to continue joining with me, my dear friends, Testmos is the only tool out of this all 6 which allows you to join without any logging required. Testmos do not require logins. Testmos generally asks the students to just type in their name and follow and attempt the quiz. Testmos only shows us 100 attempts per the quiz. You might give it to 200 students also, but you can only in the free version watch 100 students. If you want more options from Testmos, we got to buy it. But I don't think there is a need for us to buy, because in free it provides us with 100 questions, and you can give it to any number of students. So therefore, my dear friends, let's now see what is Testmos. Testmos.com. This is what it has. Testmos is simple, but it has every feature you needed. You can embed a video and then ask questions in it. You can upload images and ask questions from that. You can limit the number of times a person can take a quiz. You can also ensure that the number of students only limited number of students can access your quiz. A lot is there in Testmos. You can check out about all that in testmos.com. So this is Testmos. Let us see the demo of Testmos. So this is where we go to Testmos. I will share the screen, and I want all of you to do it also. I'll show it to you. So madam, hello madam.
Yes ma'am.
Madam, can I have the Testmos link placed in chat box?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you. My dear participants, you do not require any login. You just need to give in your name and just answer the quiz. Testmos do not require any login. It only asks you to just type your name and just do the quiz. You can click on the link shared in the chat box by our team and type the passcode POTL, all in small letters. Now you are doing it from a student's perspective. How does it look from a student's perspective is what you're going to experience when you take up this task. How to do it from a teacher's point of view, I'll tell you in a minute. So I would request all the participants to take 2 minutes of their valuable time to kindly click in the link and just explore the tool called TestMos, a free tool. So testmos.com/3897892. And you got to type in the passcode POTL. All in small letters, POTL. All throughout today's session, our aim was only to give you some kind of practical experience to a set of tools that we are using in our teaching process. So my dear friends, take this opportunity to explore tools along with us. So the tool is called TestMos, which is a very, very friendly tool. This is the link. And you just got to use POTL as the passcode and just do the quiz. Okay, let's move ahead. I'll show you how the results are seen. Let people do a job, then we'll move ahead, see another tool and come back to TestMos. Moving ahead, there are a couple of other tools which are very free for us and we can all start working with it. That is MyQuiz. MyQuiz is another beautiful platform that allows you to, you know, probably give your own quizzes. It is a very user-friendly platform. Anyone who doesn't have a great idea about creating quizzes can just simply log into MyQuiz and create their quizzes. On the top, you're finding something called Enter the Code to Quiz. How does your students do it? When you give a quiz, see, just see they're here. I gave a quiz and the code is 424126. So therefore, what do your students do? Your students will just type in the code here and join. This is what students can do. You can play a multiplayer game. You can give team assignments also in this my quiz, but we generally do a single one-to-one kind of game generally. So this is another interesting platform. This is the demo. You can see the demo here. MyQuiz.org is the website. Your test is published and is available at myquiz.org. This is the URL, 424126. My dear friends, MyQuiz requires you to log in. It asks the student to log in. So you should be probably logging in through Gmail. Give your details and then the quiz opens for you because it records. Since it records the student performances and at the teacher's end, you can get an Excel sheet of the responses of your student, it requires the student to log in. So therefore, I request all the participants to kindly open this. So let's move. Let's check out first what is happening with TestMos and MyQuiz and then come back to see the other two. I now show you what happens at a teacher end in the platforms called MyQuiz and TestMos. So friends, here I go. We're done with it puzzle, so I'm just closing it puzzle. Madam, is the screen visible? Hello, madam?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, it's visible, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So, friends, this is what you're doing, right? Okay, I got to start the game. Are you ready? My dear participants, are you ready to play my quiz? So, what are you supposed to do? So, here are the instructions. That is how it is seen to your students. So, the game starts with a question. You should answer the question and then it starts. So, my quiz. We are trying to do my quiz. 33 users got connected through the URL. So, just it's just only for explanation. So, I'll start off the quiz because we got to explore a lot. So, 37 users. I'm just starting the game. My dear participants, this is how a teacher can start the game and stop the game. I'm just starting the game. Okay. You only have got 15 seconds to answer this question. If you are doing it from a teacher's perspective, this is how, here is the place where you can check out how many are answering. Sorry for the questions. Because there are large number of participants across various domains, we restricted ourselves to giving all general questions. Because we also spoke about GRIET, some questions will also be about GRIET. GRIET is our college, Gokaraju Rangaraju Institute of Engineering and Technology. So yes, we move to the next question. Time ends, it automatically moves to the next question. So here we go, there are total 5 questions. And you are now moving to the third question. You can able to see the answers on the screen. That is how it appears. Who is there on the leaderboard is also visible to the teacher. When the teacher is doing this, he's also able to see. He or she is also able to see who is there on top. 63 answers. What is today's date? We are not branding any tool. We are not promoting any tool through our FDP. We only wish people get acquainted to as many tools as possible. When they explore whatever they love, they can use it. So this is a small attempt made from our side, the team FDP side, to ensure that you get little knowledge about a lot of tools available for free to make a job easy. So the next question is, what is the national sport of India? Answers keep coming. Yeah, exactly. It is hockey. Next question. Again, you have got 25 seconds to answer the question. What is the national fruit of India? Of course, yes, we are done. What happens when the game ends? What does the teacher get to see? The teacher gets to see the topper. SSR with 30, Sunandax with 30, Umarani with 28, lot more. So this is what I get to see. People use their short names and all. So if we insist our students to join, log in with their roll numbers and have some strict mechanism, then this becomes an important tool for us, and it also becomes easy for us to note down what's happening through this tool. So this is how it is. So quizzes list, this is how it's scored. This is the leaderboard. After you're done, you can download. This tool allows you to download. So this is how I do. My dear friends, how do you do this? Let me now show it from a teacher's point of view. You just open myquiz.org and then create your account, log in, then you find something called as create quiz. I just go to create quiz. A very simple platform, has got nothing much to do. Everything is inbuilt. This is the topic that you're talking about. Say I'm suppose telling like EdTech tools, which is also our mail ID. So I'm just writing EdTech tools. Then you have to got to give any description. You can give it here. If you want to write any code, when do you want to start? Say now I want to start. So I'll put on today's date and time. Date and time. Automatic start. Do you want to start it automatically? I selected no because I wanted to show it today. So that's why I selected no. But if you want your students to immediately start off as soon as the link is given to them, you can simply say S and start doing it. Here goes. Custom time settings will allow you to set time for each question. But in general, I wanted all my questions to get 30 seconds or 25 seconds. Then you can do this. This is 25 seconds. After that, you save and go to the next part. Very, very simple platform. So here it goes. It allows you to show the question, true or false. What kind of question do you want? Again, whatever answer you want to add, this becomes. If this is correct, you will just put yes. Example, let me show it to you. Okay, let me type a question first. So, today is Saturday. Sorry for my questions. Today is Saturday. So then comes two answers. It can be yes or it can be no, or in the words, true or false. In general, it can be true or false. So therefore, if I feel that true is the correct answer, I mark it like this. That's it. I'm done. If you want to add one more choice, true, false, say suppose I want to add another choice called don't know, then this is how you got to add. Sorry. Yeah. If you add something called true or false and then you add something called don't know, this is how you will add don't know. After that, again, add a question. If you want to add on more questions, simply add question. Choose what type of question you want it to be. Here is an option for you to choose. What type of question you want it to be, and then go ahead. It can be true, false, multiple choice questions, open-ended questions, nothing but fill in the blanks. A lot. And this is how the tool works. When you want to check out the answers, you can go to the results page and check out how is it working for your students. So this is about the one that I wanted to show. This is my quiz. So my dear friends, let me take you through test. Okay. I did not save my quiz. I'm just closing it because the more windows I open becomes a problem. So I just close it. Let me take you through a tool called TestMoose. How to work with TestMoose from a teacher's perspective. Hope you have seen how does TestMoose work from a student's perspective. So let us now see how to work with TestMoose from a teacher's perspective. The advantage of TestMoose, there is little advantage with TestMoose and a bit of disadvantage with TestMoose. TestMoose does not even allow user to log in. Just like how MyQuiz allows me to log in with my Gmail account as a teacher and create quizzes, TestMoose do not accept any sign-ins until unless we are a paid subscriber. So therefore, what does it require? It requires all the teaching staff to remember the URL. So let me show it to you. I've just opened my TestMoose. So I don't have any login because the moment I say login, it asks me to pay. So I don't want to pay any money. So therefore I just check out what is the advantage of TestMoose is clearly seen here. If you want to check out any policy of a particular quiz on any quizzing platform, there is something called as pricing. My dear friends, you can go to this option called pricing and check out. It is clearly written. You're not interested in the proprietary version. So therefore check out what does this TestMoose free version do. You can build and distribute and collect the results of a basic test for free. You're limited to 50 questions and 100 results per test. That means my quiz can only have 50 questions maximum and 100 students maximum. So this is the maximum that I can use. Obviously my class strength is 60. So therefore I'll make it two work. If I teach to two sections, I'll make two copies of the test. Copy one to section one, copy two to section two. This is what I do basically. So simply you just need to build a test. Here are a few things. Test name. You got to give a test name. Say suppose I've got a lot of names. This is the POTL day 6 FDP. So let me again do this with the same EdTech FTP demo. So choose a password. Okay, let me choose a password. Okay, I've chosen a password. So my dear friends, there is a warning here. It is very important because you don't sign in to TestMos. It becomes extremely important for all of us to just check how it works. So therefore, you got to remember the password and the URL for this. So there is a URL that comes. You got to remember both. All of you are supposed to remember password and the URL. It is not a problem with any other quizzing platform that I told, because they allow you to sign in. Because TestMos does not allow us to create an account until unless we are the paid members for TestMos, we got to just remember the URL. So take a notepad, just remember the URL. This is the one that I got to remember. Or the easy way that I do is I'll just bookmark it. I'll just do Control D. Done. So the moment I talk about this comes, TestMos. But this URL, remembering this URL is extremely important. So it is absolutely critical for you to do this. That's what it says. Remember your password also. Adjust settings. If you have got nothing, then simply go to add questions. I only want to add one or two questions and show you why is this so very important or what am I talking about. So let's just add a multiple choice question. So here it is. You got to type in your question. What is, again, let me take the same question. What is today's date? Okay. I write 13. I write 14. I write 15. And I write don't know. Okay. Sorry. 15. And I write don't know. I'm not going to explain you much as we are running out of time. So this is how it works. We just want to give you an introduction to how the tool works. So my dear friends, whichever is the right answer, generally you got to again have validations and check the right answer. That doesn't become an issue here. Whichever is the right answer, just click on it. That's it. That becomes right. Automatically, that will be treated as the right answer. So if you want to insert another question, there are two ways. If you want to copy the same, click on this plus symbol. Otherwise, again, there is an insert box here. Just go to true or false and start typing what is true or what is false. Continue like this. Okay, so let me just type two questions and just publish it. So, yeah. Today is Sunday. Yes, today is Sunday. Obviously, the answer is false. Any explanation you want to give, that can be given, but I wanted to limit here. That's it. I only have two questions. So two graded questions and zero ungraded questions. You can add 50 graded questions for your TestMos quiz. So therefore, questions will automatically shuffled. TestMos does this by default. So therefore, these is my questions. And then what do? I just go to publish. Publishing is putting it ready. So this is the interesting feature of TestMos. Sometimes when we put a quiz, we also try to copy it and save it as a question bank from in our end. Whenever you write on any online platform the questions, we also prefer storing it as a offline Word copy or a document at our end. Generally, a few platforms provide that and a few platforms doesn't provide that. So how does TestMos make this job done? There is an option called in publish. There is an option called download as Word document. So when you do this, you got to just, you know, do you want it with answers or without answers? I don't want with answers. I want a fresh copy so that I can use that as a on-paper exam also. So therefore, I just say view, print or download. When I view, print or download, I exactly get a clear test exam kind of paper in which I'm able to probably, you know, create a paper exam also. Here is what all of you can check, I guess. Madam, is the screen visible?
Yes, madam.
Thank you.
Yes.
So here is a download. Here is a download of the quiz that I have just published. This is the only thing that I got to wait for a second. Okay. It opens automatically. It's opening. So we'll see how does a paper copy of the test looks like. Friends, now that I'm doing screen sharing, the paper copy might not be visible to you, but I will try to show it to you. Okay, or else, we'll do one thing. I will just immediately after my session, for your information, I will immediately put this document that got downloaded in the WhatsApp group so that all of you can check it. it might become a little more time taking. So just we'll just skip this off. I'm closing test MOS. So this is about test MOS, another tool that I wanted to show it to you. So let me go to another interesting tool, that is Quizzes. Yeah. This is another interesting platform, Quizzes. We are coming to the end of a session. We'll just look at one more tool after Quizzes and we'll wind up the session. So here we are, Quizzes, another interesting platform that makes a job easy. This requires login for both student and teacher. Both of us, I mean, both the teacher and the student requires to login because Quizzes generally documents the results. So since it documents the results, it expects the students to login. So therefore, my dear friends, this is the Quizzes platform. So this is how it works. On the teacher side, teacher cannot see the questions. She can only see the leaderboard. But from the student side, they can simply start it. So I already have an account, so I just log in. Sorry. So madam, can I have the Quizzes link pasted in feedback, in the chat box?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, madam.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
It's pasted.
Thank you. Friends, the link for the exam is pasted. Interested participants can just click on the link. Interested participants can click on the link and play the game with me. Yeah, this is me. This is my Quizzes platform. I have constructed a lot of quizzes for my students using Quizzes. So this is how it gets. My dear friends, this is how it is, reports. So let me first show you this. I created, like, this is how I created. 71 students attended, 16 students did it. This is POTL FDP quiz demo. This is what it's running now. So 18 students did it. This is a live quiz I've completed long back ago. Accuracy is this. This is the amount of accuracy that I received. This is how it worked. This is how it works. So these are the results. After that, you can check the results. So if you want to see, you can just download Excel. You can do that also. Now I'm not interested. So let's go ahead. I'm not interested in downloading anything. So therefore, I prefer
Snake video. Snake video. Snake video.
Sunita ma'am. Thank you. So yes, here it is. Oh, 16 people are already doing. Okay. So this is how it looks. If you want to create a new quiz, you just go to create new quiz. Again, you just give a given name. Suppose demo quiz. Okay. You just go next. You got to select one or the other thing. Say, suppose I selected some professional development and just said next. Okay, this is how Quizzes shows. Quizzes is another interesting, simple platform. It requires you to give a multiple choice question, or you want to give a checkbox, that means many questions, or a fill in the blank, or a poll question, or an open-ended question. So this is how you can play with it. Multiple choice, this is how Quizzes works. But before that, let us play with quiz. So let me go to Quizzes again. Okay, let me start off with my quizzes. Yeah, POTL FDP quiz. This is what is running. This is what I have done. This is how it looks. This is how it looks, my dear friends. I have created some 5 questions. I gave an image. Quizzes generally ask for an image as the entrance of, you know, as the first page of a quiz. So therefore, I have uploaded our brochure. Then I've started. Any editing that you want to do, you can edit here. Play live, assign homework. These are all the options. If I want my people to play with me now, I can do this. Assign as homework. So generally, what is my idea of this Quizzes and Kahoot is, I usually first play live with my students in my online class. After that, if I feel that the students need to learn a lot, there are a few mistakes that happened, then what do I do is, I usually check this assign homework or practice. Practice allows a student to learn as many times as possible until he's perfect. So therefore, this is how my approach would be. I generally play a game live in my class. After that, I open the link for 2 days and just allow my students to practice so that any small mistakes they have committed, they might not do it again. So this is my version of doing it. So let's play live. What does people, there are actually a few students who have started. Okay, this is play live. This is the option that you got to select, classic test team. A lot comes in this picture. So you just got to see what works for you. So then just say continue. I've given 2 attempts for this. I only wanted to see how it works once. So this is what we are trying to do. When you got to do this, this is what you're supposed to do. My dear friends, my dear participants, I request you to kindly join the game with me. Join myquiz.com and enter the game code 873901. Or if you are a teacher who's thinking of this, when you say play live, here is a link, share via. I copy the link. Okay, and then what do? I go to the chat box and I paste it. This is also, I can do, if I'm doing a Zoom classroom, imagine that I'm doing a Zoom classroom with my students. I copy the link, I paste it in the chat box and send it to every one of my students. And I close it. So done. This is how. Only one participant has joined me. Let 10 to 15 people join. I'll quickly wind up. As a teacher, this is how you see it at your end. Teacher got to start the game because I'm playing it live with my students. On the bottom left corner, you will find a people symbol and the number of people joining you. If you want to stop the game in between, if you felt like the game needs to be stopped in between, then just click on the end game that is seen on the screen. Okay, I'm just proceeding. So this is how it looks. There is an introduction timer. It says 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Oh. People are like on top of this. This is what a teacher finds at her end. I don't want music. Music is only for that feeling of video games. You may or may not use music. There is a control that rests with the teacher. So you can use that. And this is how my students are doing. The 3 points, 4 points up is they have just climbed those many points. And this is how it is. So this is how it's happening. If I want to stop in between, what is the amount of accuracy they are answering? This is what we get. This is what the points people are getting. Right answers, wrong answers. This is how you can check. And these details, you can also download it as an Excel sheet as well. So I just wanted to end the game. End game. It says people are still doing. My dear friends, I know our time is valuable. Now that you got the exposure to this tool, I wish you take this forward. So at this point of time, when you end the game, that's what, on top, you get all your top three performers. And that's it. That's how you got to do. So yes, the advantage of test modes is also this. Even through test modes, I can find out which student have answered a question right and which student have answered a question wrong, which student did not attempt. So my dear friends, here, Dr. Padmaja has not answered the fifth question. And Syed Monisha did not answer the fifth question wrong. Here, they did not answer the fifth question. So this can be easily checked with us. This is how, see these many number of participants and a few answered and a few did not. So this is what is seen at download results. The moment I say download results, it just opens up in a new file and gets me the answers. So it just gives me the answers. So download results, it just downloads an Excel file to me. I'll place this for your understanding. How does it look from a student's point of view? If you want to understand, I'll place this for you. So I now even stop this quizzes also. So the last topic of the day, my dear friends, let me introduce you to another interesting platform, that is Kahoot. So let me take you through another important platform, that is Kahoot. So a new quiz that we are seeing now is Kahoot. Madam, please place the Kahoot link in feedback form. Sorry.
Yeah, it's there, ma'am. I have
the chat box. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I have done.
Thank you. So Kahoot is another interesting environment that is for free. Kahoot has given a lot of options during COVID-19. During this pandemic time, Kahoot gave us a number of options. It almost given us a freedom to take as many quizzes as possible, extended all the limits. But still, Kahoot still remains to be free with few options. Kahoot Premium, this is what my account is. Am I logged in into Kahoot? Okay. So this is my Kahoot account. Kahoot.com. Kahoot.com is the account. So when I log in, this is what I see. A lot of people around the world are using Kahoot. So I got to log in. So I use login option to log in. My dear friends, I have already an account with Kahoot. So that's why login does my job. But for you, you need to sign up using your Gmail account and then use it. Also to tell you, Kahoot quizzes, my quiz, all these can be embedded into your Google Classroom. You need not just use Google Forms. You can create a quiz in Kahoot and just share the URL through your Google Classroom. Even that is possible. All the results are also can be viewed in your Drive directly. So this is my Kahoot. I have created actually a lot of quizzes through Kahoot. So when I go there, I go to my Kahoots. My Kahoots is a place where I quiz, where I generally do. So this one, let me take it. Let me first take you through the experience of using Kahoot, and then I will show what all does a teacher got to do. My dear friends, whenever I go into Kahoot, I log in. There is an option called Create. I should select Create. If I'm a teacher, I will select Create. Then I will use Create. This is how Kahoot looks like this when I create it. Colors is important in Kahoot. Why? I will tell you in a minute. This is the time limit. You want to a minimum of 5 seconds, minimum of 5 seconds to a maximum of 240 seconds. Anytime you wish, you can give it. For some questions, you feel it is 20 seconds, you can give 20. For some, you can give 30, 60, 90, 120, 240. Inbuilt. You can set the time limit as per your requirement. Then there are a few options here. How many answers do I have? If I select a multiple choice question, it can have a single answer. It can have a multiple answer. So if you feel that your question has multiple answers, got to select the second option. If you feel that your question has just one answer, you got to select the first option. So this is how you proceed with Kahoot. So here I write a question. Again, I write my solid question is water. Okay. Yeah. Where is GRIET? We expect it to be in Hyderabad. So the answer is, So I felt the answer, okay. I just opened this. A maximum of 75 characters can be given. So I write is Hyderabad. I tell you why is it. If you feel that this is the correct answer, just put a tick. That's it. Rest all. Because there is only one answer here, I just write it Bangalore. Okay. Because that's a wrong answer, no worries. Then comes the next question. Then comes the next option. Whatever you want to do, you can do it. Okay. So then comes the next question. That is Chennai. And then your final answer, whatever you want to give. Okay, suppose I want to say Goa. Okay. Yeah, this is how it looks. Interested in adding an image kind of question or a video kind of question, you can just drag and drop the URL here or the file here so that it gets automatically added and when it is seen, is shown on the screen. So where is GRIT is the question I have just added. So my dear friends, this is how you got to keep on adding questions. When you want to just add, simply say add question, add question, add question. There is another interesting option called as import from spreadsheet. that requires little more explanation, but in short, I'll finish in a minute. My dear friends, import from spreadsheet is a concept where you download a spreadsheet, type in all your questions in your Excel, and then upload it to Kahoot. Rather than doing this manually, you can directly do it through an Excel sheet if you already have questions. So that's another interesting option that Kahoot provides us. You can try it in case of your free time, but let me tell you what is that particular disadvantage of Kahoot. Friends, the disadvantage or what is that which people miss out in Kahoot is you can only see the question on the teacher's platform. Oh, sorry, let me tell you again. There are two options in which Kahoot can be used. In one option, when you are doing a live Kahoot, when the Kahoot is live, just like how we did it for quizzes, in that case, in quizzes, the question is seen at the student's end. But in Kahoot, when we are going live, the question is seen at the teacher's end and the answer options are only seen at the student's end. So we will play, you will understand. I will do a live session for you. So this is how you got to create your Kahoots. Done, I just simply say done. I got to give a title, so I just gave demo. And I'm just continuing because I don't want to do anything with this. Okay, done. I don't want to test anything here, so I go back to my Kahoots. We will wind up in another 5 minutes. So I just go to my Kahoots. This is my library where my Kahoots are there. So this is the one that I'm going to launch. Expecting that all the participants who have joined us today are our regular participants. All the questions in this Kahoot game are clearly and truly based on our FDP. We organized a 6-day FDP and how much you have learned. What is about the 6-day FDP? You can get to know through this game. So my dear friends, when I do this, there are a lot of options. I have an option called play. Just go there, click on play. There are two things here. Teach is for virtual classroom and assign is for self-paced learning. So as I told you, I initially teach it in my virtual classroom. I make my students do live in my class and then I will assign it for my students to do on their own. So whenever you do it in the second option called assign, the students can also see the question on their, as seen in the figure, the students can see the question followed by the options. But here, when you do it live, only the teacher can see the questions. Only the teacher screen has the question and the students only have got colors. So how does Kahoot Teach work? So let me start. Because we are doing it on a virtual classroom, let me directly give you this experience. If you are interested in playing it offline also, I will share the link post the session. So this is how it works. Kahoot is now doing. It again allows you to take it in two modes. I would like to take it in a classic mode where, as I believe, student by student kind of interaction happens. So yes, as the Kahoot link is placed in the chat box, my dear friends, at times music sounds good, but now at this point of time, I don't want music to trouble us. So I've just stopped, disabled music, but Kahoot by default gives you music at the background. So my dear friends, we are waiting for the players. Please go to kahoot.it. Please go to kahoot.it. You are joined with your nicknames or some assigned names by Kahoot. Go to kahoot.it. Or you can download Kahoot app in your mobile and use the game code 888-7-7-3. 888-7-3-3. Requesting participants to join the Kahoot quiz with us. The last for the day. We will close in another 5 minutes. So well, my dear friends, I'm joined by 52 participants. So I'll quickly start. Okay, people keep coming. Let them come. I'm just starting the session, starting the quiz. Dear participants, the fastest gets more marks in Kahoot. The questions are only seen at the speaker's end, teacher's end, and the students got to first see the question, see the option, and then go back and do. So here is the first question. Who is the day one speaker of POTL FDP? POTL is Perspectives of Online Teaching and Learning. Our FDP, who is day one speaker? Remat sir, Prashant sir, Kuldeep sir, and Praveen sir. Just click on the color which you felt is the right answer option. This is how we join. There is another option if you are able to see, game join. If I close this, then no other people can join, but I'm just allowing people to join. On the right corner, you can also find the number of students who have answered this. At times, suppose if you want to skip a question, you can simply say skip and the question gets skipped. I have actually given 45 seconds for each question. So now I just wanted to skip it. So let us see. This is how it's seen on the platform. So whenever a teacher is giving a quiz, Kahoot quiz to the students check the teacher screen, learns the question, learns the option, and then goes and marks the answer. So this is how it works. This is how it happens. 31 said red, that is Remat sir. Exactly, it is Remat sir. Dr. Remat J. Dias is our day one speaker. So followed by all this, which are wrong. So let's proceed to the next one. After you're done, we'll see a scoreboard. I'm just skipping because we are running out of time. Who's a day two speaker? Dear participants, it is only to give you an experience of how to work with Kahoot. So take your time, go back, check out the teacher screen, find the answer option, and then click it correctly. Okay, 60 answers have come, so I'm just skipping. Yes, the second year speaker is Dr. Kuldeep Bansoth. Then immediately you'll find a leaderboard coming up. All this, I repeat, again is an option that rests with teacher. You can have your leaderboard. You may not have your leaderboard after end of every question. That's absolutely your wish. But that gives, whenever you imbibe a leaderboard in between the session, that gives a competitive feeling for students. My students have actually experienced that. They like that jumping up positions and all that stuff, just like how it happens in video games. So therefore, I usually keep leaderboards. So yes, the day three speaker. Okay, we'll just skip after I receive a few answers. It is Prashant sir. Next we'll go. There are a couple of jumpings happening in the leaderboard. We'll see towards the end. Who is the day four speaker? This is also a kind of effort that we all constructively put in to tell thank you to all our speakers of this POTL FDP. So yes, our day four speaker is exactly Sri Vijay Ramarajgaru. Associate Professor GRIET. That's how people keep jumping. Let's move to the next question. Who is our day five speaker? Day five is yesterday's session. Who is our day five speaker? Yes, I'll just skip it. Yes, it is exactly Dr. J. Praveen, Principal GRIT, is our day five speaker at the POTL FDP. So let's move. Okay, next time I'll pause on this leaderboard. Who told about, whose topic was free software tools in POTL FDP? Which speaker spoke about free software tools in our FDP? which speakers spoke about POTL tools in RFDP. Sorry, free software tools in RFDP. So his answer keeps coming. I'll just move. Excuse me, participants, kindly please, because we are running out of time and we don't want to keep you waiting for a long time. We are just, I'm just running it. So yes, it is Rehmat sir. Let me check how it goes. Exactly. So at this point of time, if I want to end the quiz, there is a lot more. I actually have 10 questions to this, but if at this point of time, if I want to end the quiz, I'd simply say end the quiz. So after the quiz is ended, this is how you get this. Someone with a nickname Helpful Duck is in the third place. Smooth Mouse is in second place. And there comes the topper with 7124 points, Eager Panther. If your students log in with their names or roll numbers, you can able to quickly find their results. So that's how Kahoot helps us. This creates a kind of gamification and a kind of Kaun Banega Karodpati type of feeling in students. Because after day one of launching this Kahoot in my class, when I just asked my people to give their feedback, this is what people have told me. So you can also ask it. There's something called as Get Feedback. When I post this, the people can type anything. After your job is done, you can save your results, you can view your report, or you can play again as well. If I say save my results, it directly gets saved to my drive, to my Google Drive, in which I have logged into Kahoot. So that's it from my side, my dear friends. I'll just take a minute and stop. I only take one more minute and stop. So stop sharing. Madam, give me a minute, I'll close. Just give me a minute.
Sure, ma'am, take your time.
Just a minute, I'll close. So my dear friends, my dear participants, thank you so much for being with us all throughout today. So hopefully we delivered what is expected of us. Our intention was purely to let the participants from our diverse background know a variety of tools that are freely available at this point of time. Madam, please. So this is it. So my dear friends, let me just take a minute and thank you all. This is how it is. The PPT will be shared. So this is what I want to say and conclude. Technology is just a tool. In terms of getting the kids working together and motivating them, the teacher is the most important, as quoted by Bill Gates. My dear friends, I as a teacher and you all as teachers, we still believe thrown into any kind of situation, we arise, we learn, we relearn, and we probably, you know, unlearn if needed to get to what we are. The teacher is always the most important and cannot be replaced. On that note, I salute all such wonderful teachers who took a lot of pressures during this time and still made a point and a mark in their students' life. Thank you so much, friends. Over to the team. Thank you, guys.
I, Sugna, express my gratitude to you, Sandhya ma'am. Thank you so much. We have inspired with your talk today. Thanks for sparing your valuable time with us.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, before going to question and answer session, with your permission, shall we launch a poll question?
Sure. Go ahead.
Yes, I request Mr. A. Kapil Kumar to launch the poll question. Please, sir. And the question is, what are the major problems you as a teacher faced for your online classes? The options are lack of digital skill set, lack of resources, unfamiliarity of teaching online, time management. Dear participants, please answer the poll question. It is mandatory to answer the poll question for our administrative purpose. Poll question will be ended within a short period. Voted. It's 10 seconds. So we are ending the poll question. So 29% has voted for lack of digital skill set, and 26% lack of resources, 29% unfamiliarity of teaching online, and 17% time management. Thank you, dear participants. Now I request the participants to raise their hand for your question and answer session. Now I request Aishi to unmute from your side and ask the question. Miss Aishi. Okay, now I request Ishita to unmute from your side and ask the question. Now I request Mr. Satish to unmute yourself and ask the question.
Well, good afternoon, madam. Well, are you able to hear me, madam?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, inade meer cheptattu adenti oka image ni chunchi adenti dani Microsoft document tho open chesinappudu adenti danka unna language tho adi printed material ochindi.
అవును సార్.
అలాగే ఇప్పుడు అదే డాక్యుమెంట్ లో రెండు డ్యూయల్ లాంగ్వేజ్ ఉన్నాయి అనుకోండి, ఇంగ్లీష్ అండ్ తెలుగు, లైక్ ఇంగ్లీష్ అండ్ హిందీ, అప్పుడు రెండు 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 ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ వస్తాయి.
వస్తుంది సార్, హ్యాండ్ రిటన్ కూడా వస్తుంది సార్. ఓకే, హ్యాండ్ రిటన్ కూడా అవుతుంది సార్. మేము ట్రై చేసాము, కాకపోతే స్క్రిప్ట్ క్లారిటీని బట్టి ఎడిటింగ్ కొంచెం తక్కువ వస్తుందా ఎక్కువ వస్తుందా అని డిపెండ్ అవుతుంది సార్. ఇట్ డిపెండ్స్ ఆన్ ద స్క్రిప్ట్ క్లారిటీ, బట్ యు విల్ గెట్ ఇట్ సార్. For that, and I took screenshot from this one also. Newspaper screenshot kuda teeskunnanu, meer chusuntaru.
Ah, avunu chusanu. And like any explanation is regarding the diagrams, then how it is going to make it?
You only need to have a tool, sir. Google Docs doesn't allow you. Text is only converted through Google Doc.
Right.
But if the diagrams are of some kind of strict diagrams, then you might get it. Squares, rectangles, ala solid figures, aithe kanaka, there is a chance of restoring. I wish you to check out more in the help URL. I'll share the PPT, sir. You can just check out.
Okay, thank you, madam. And I would like to share one more information. Well, yesterday I have attended the session by your principal, sir, Praveen, sir. But unfortunately, I could not able to submit my poll question.
Yes, sir. It's okay. No problem. We have recorded your attendance. You please write to EdTech Tools. Any issues like that, you can write to EdTech Tools. Thank you. Thank you.
Now I request Mr. Kirti Narayan to unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yeah, very good afternoon, ma'am. I'm a regular participant.
Hi,
of
sir,
this.
Good afternoon.
I keep on asking questions to every possible ends.
No, and I'm a little practitioner. With us is like, very happy for all of us joining from such a far place, and being so regular makes us happy, sir. It's just fulfills the purpose.
Sure, ma'am. I'm a dental practitioner, ma'am, and I'm a dental faculty. It was very interesting today, all these quizzes. Even I feel like I have gone to my school days where I keep on asking questions, like answer. I was the flying goat participant, was there in the top four. I just missed by a point.
Oh, wow. Okay, many, many congratulations.
Even the poll was my question only. I've given time management, which I felt very difficult to manage, ma'am. So can you give me some suggestions? Because Zoom and all, you know, it's restricted to 40 minutes and we cannot take classes in Google Meet where we have so much restrictions. I have to cover so much of clinical aspect to all the case histories. It's very difficult to conclude in a 40 minutes, ma'am. Can you give us small suggestions from your experience?
Sir, we like our team, the team which is handling this FDP. At the start of this COVID session, we were exploring randomly tools only with us, not with students. Like one of us became teacher, the other became students. We explored all possible tools. At this point of time, Google Meet is the one which is giving large amount of time, but it has its own demerits. Because yes, you got to admit students personally, and it doesn't record. So you got to have another tool to record. But at this point of time, I felt GoToMeeting is a better option, sir, at this point of time. Because GoToMeeting does not have the restriction of 40 minutes for now, till this COVID session. I don't know after COVID or maybe after a month, what will all these people do? They might restrict us to only limited time. But the free version at present of GoToMeeting, which only allows 14 days trial, gives us ample time to record. Maybe 2 hours class also.
So we are in a long phase, ma'am. We don't know still how many months it will go on. We'll keep on attending all these programs. At the end of the day, we don't know where we are ending up. So all these while now they are starting, and yesterday Sir Praveen sir was telling a very valid point. We don't know when they are going to make Google Pay for these events.
Sure.
So ma'am, how we can restrict, ma'am? Okay, let it be like a 40 minutes. Can you give me a small suggestions? Like, can we restrict the slides as you said, more of the words perspective? We can give them a Google Docs or a PDF or. What we can do is like we can split sessions. We don't want to stress the students also. Can we split sessions and take, ma'am? Will it be fine?
That's an absolute idea, sir. You have to probably the only option at this point of time. If suppose all the free software providers restrict ourselves to very limited time, then most of us may be not in a position to pay and then take a class. Even the institutes at this point of time might or might not be ready to pay for solid tools. So what I believe is. Record a video at your end using some free tools. We will post even those URLs also towards the end of the day today. Sure, so record a video, which is not so very important, just the introduction part. Send it to your students beforehand. Upload it to your Google Drive, which is better. And in the class session, which is a limited time, concentrate on the most important topic or the crux. That's what we are also planning to do, sir, from now on.
Yes, I've already started preparing quiz for my students, so they'll be ready on Kahoot on Monday.
Thank you, sir. Congratulations. Thank you.
I'm looking forward for a very excellent session, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am.
Dear participants, the overall feedback, if anybody want to give orally. Just you can raise your hands. Remaining, you can lower your hands. Some 2 to 3 people, please give your feedback on the whole FDP program. Now I request Dr. Sharanya to unmute herself and speak a few words regarding the feedback of FDP. Dr. Sharanya. Are you present? Now I request Dr. Nirmal to unmute from his side and give his valuable feedback on the FDP.
Hello.
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. Audible. Yes, ma'am. You're audible, please.
Actually, you were talking about certain quizzes, and so we have a drawback in Google Classroom where we can't monitor the timings for the test for the students to submit their answers. So can these apps like quizzes and Kahoot can be converted into a app for tests and other things?
Yeah, ma'am. That's what I was about to... Yeah, yeah, exactly. The problem with... madam, even in Google form also, you can limit the number of response... I mean, you can limit the time. But that requires a special add-on, madam. Okay. There is an add-on called form limiter. If you want our team, I mean, we will share the link in the WhatsApp groups also. Okay. So there's an add-on called form limiter, which if you add to your Google form, will allow you to start and stop responses, just like how we are doing it for our feedback form in this entire event. We are restricting the feedback form open only till 1 p.m.
Ma'am, but in Kahoot, we have limited seconds, like,
no? Questions.
That option we are not finding in Google form.
Yeah, that is
so
not
because
there.
In Google form, it's most of aptitude and like MCQ only.
Yes, ma'am.
So if this time limit can be applied to that, to Kahoot, and instead of playing a game in Kahoot, if that can be used for assessments, how far the Kahoot will work with that?
Yes, ma'am. I only showed you a version where I'm talking about a virtual classroom.
Okay.
There is another option called as assignment and assign. That you can check out. That probably provides a better solution, ma'am. If not Kahoot, the other three quizzes or four quizzes that we shared today also have so many better options. Many better options for taking it as a strict assessment.
Okay.
Even my quiz, which you have taken, quizzes which you have taken towards the end of the session, also has an option called, a test assessment. If you take up that link, that will become a better option, madam.
Okay. Thank you.
Now I request Ms. M. N. Aparna to unmute herself and give her valuable feedback.
Thank you, ma'am, for organizing such a good session. And we feel really delighted to be in the session all through the journey. And I came across one more quiz option, like a quiz bot. Mm. So that's also good, but I could do it in Telegram app, but I could not find how to do it in WhatsApp, and I'm trying to know about that. Do you have any idea about this, ma'am?
Sorry, ma'am. I did not explore the tool yet. So now that you have told us, we'll together explore, ma'am.
Yeah, sure, ma'am. Yeah. Because I could do it in Telegram, but I...
Yes. There are a large number of bot apps coming now. We have seen that, but we have not explored. This one is only till these apps, but we'll surely explore together, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Ma'am, let's just proceed for vote of thanks. Ma'am, shall we?
Dear participants, the feedback link is posted in the chat box. Please fill. Sorry, ma'am. The online FDP, Perspectives of Online Teaching and Learning, concludes today. On any given day, there are around 400 participants online for the FDP, and we are sure all of them have benefited from the vast experience and expertise of the resource persons. The lectures by the resource persons were informative, inspiring, and motivating. The online mode of conducting an FDP had its own challenges and advantages. Dear participants, we invite you to give your overall feedback on the FDP. You may raise your hands, okay? Thanks for the participation and giving your valuable feedback. Dear participants, before the vote of thanks, I would like to inform you that the e-certificate will be sent to the participants on their registered email ID within a week or so. So we will be in contact with you through WhatsApp. Over to Ms. Sunita.
Thank you. I, KCH Sunita, coordinator of this FDP, on behalf of the team FDP, Department of Humanities and Sciences, GRIT, feel privileged to propose the vote of thanks to all those who helped to make this FDP happen. First and foremost, we express our gratitude and thanks to our resource persons Dr. Ramath J. Diaz, Dr. Kuldeep Bansod, Dr. Prashad Aragir, Mr. Vijay Ramaraj Garu, Dr. J. Praveen Garu, and Ms. STGY Sandhya for spending their valuable time and sharing their treasured knowledge. I extend our sincere thanks to our management for giving us this opportunity to conduct this online FDP. I also express my gratitude to our Chief Executive Officer, Sri M.G. Shekaram Garu, Dr. Director Dr. Jandiala N. Murthy Garu, Senior Administrative Officer Dr. K.V.S. Raj Garu for the constant encouragement and motivation. I would also like to express our profound gratitude to our principal, Dr. J. Praveen Garu, for gracing yesterday's session on digital technology. Thank you, sir, for your very interesting and thought-provoking address. I also thank our beloved HOD and convener of this FDP, Dr. B. Srinivas Rao Garu, for his moral support and guidance in all our device activities of this FDP and ensure that we always do the right thing in the right way. I would like to extend a special thanks to Dr. P. Gopalkrishna Garu, Dean Publicity Grit, for his minute-to-minute support and adequate training to conduct this FDP in an easy way. I also thank Dr. J. Kishore Babu Garu for giving his valuable inputs to us, irrespective of time. An event of this dimension can't happen overnight and needs meticulous planning and execution. I cannot thank each one enough of my team for their involvement and the willingness they have expressed to take on the completion of the work beyond their comfort zone. So I would thank my team and acknowledge their immense contribution. Lastly, I extend my thanks and regards to all the participants who have turned up in such great number, not only from our department, rather also from other departments of various institutions. Thank you so much for your cordial cooperation. Thank you, everyone. Dear participants, let's end up the session and our FDP as announced. Your e-certificates will be mailed to you within a week or so. Hope you have submitted today's feedback. The feedback is still in the chat box. Dear participants, kindly submit your feedback before you leave. For any of your queries, you at any time may write to edtechtoolsfdp.grit@gmail.com. Sandhya ma'am, would you like to say something?
Yeah, ma'am. Point number one. My dear participants, if anyone has to give their feedback, written feedback about this FDP, you can write it in the chat box. The chat is kept open for participants to write their FDP, give their FDP to make us better. Also, in case if you have any issues or if you want to personally write to us, we are always accessible through edtechtoolsftp.grit@gmail.com. So we will keep the chat box open for another 5 minutes. We request all the participants, whoever is interested to give us an oral feedback, a written feedback, can just post their feedback in the feedback, in the chat box. Thank you.
Kapil sir, can you please end the session, end the meeting?